turn the mic over so that we can engage in a little discussion.
So what do you think? Well, I appreciate you coming and watching. I'll be glad to take questions. Don't hesitate. Any question? Yes?
I've got a question about the brain itself. I mean, from the models that you had, it looks like the prefrontal cortex looks like the sides and so forth. I mean, is there any difference in brain matter structure there? Or is it sort of like a computer where on a hard disk you have partitions, but something else really runs the brain?
Well, it's, you know, I think we tend, for the sake of communication and understanding, we usually come up with compartmentalization of brain activity. There is some particular activity that happens in a particular part of the brain. For example, in majority of the humans, the speech is on the left side in this area, and the visual cortex is here. So in the same fashion, the contemplation and critical thinking, it lays in the front part of the brain called prefrontal cortex, which is one of the newest part of the brain that developed over thousands of years and millions of years through species, different species. So that's the part that deals with this activity, but the neurons are not so particularly different than other neurons. It's just where a particular activity happens.
But it be switched into another portion? I mean, if they're basically, the neurons are the same.
No, you can't, because the other parts of the brain are doing different activities. For example, the left, the right parietal cortex that I mentioned deals with the so-called spatial orientation. It tells us that I'm standing here, this is my right side, left side, and when there's damage to it, you lose the spatial orientation. So each part of the brain, the neurons in that part of the brain have unique function. That's why when you have a stroke, there is some plasticity of the surrounding neurons that may pick up some of that activity, but if there's a significant number of neurons that are dead, that function is lost forever. And you see it in all the people with all kinds of strokes. It may be more plastic in younger children, and the brain, the surrounding brain may be able to compensate and build some of that activities, but not usually in adults. Yes?
I noticed a lot of it obviously concerned the big three religions. I was wondering if you had thoughts on some of the animists and things like that.
Well, you know, animism, as you know, is the idea of giving spirits to everything around a particular, around us in the world. The American Indians give spirits to everything. And a lot of the African tribes still believe in that. But that is very primitive religion. And as civilization improves, the animism declines. And they come up with different gods. And one of the first gods actually that was created in the form of humans was a fertility goddess actually. It started around Mesopotamia, which is Iraq, and then it went around the what's called the Golden Crescent, which is India, Pakistan, and all those areas. They recognized the importance of females. I think all men recognize the importance of females. By the way, I want to say hi to my sister-in-law who's sitting right here. So the animism part dies according to the advancing of civilization. And right now, then what happened was the anthropomorphism started, which is that humans created gods in their own image. You know. But that is also dying now. If you take all the major religions, once upon a time, the so-called monotheistic religions, which is Christianity, Judaism, and Islam, had many gods before. But then they realized, no, it really doesn't work that way. So they created this idea of a single god. But even those gods, except in Islam, where they don't give any form to Allah. They say he's formless, but they use the word he. So it's a contradiction. But, you know, if you really think about it, it doesn't make sense. But human brain has the capability to believe in something that's obviously irrational, but because it does something good to them. So a lot of these believers don't question, you know, the sex of the god, the form of the god. It's okay whether they call it he or not and still say it's, he is formless, you know. So what's happening even now, and of course the religion continues to evolve, and there are many people who say, well, you know, the idea of a benevolent, all-powerful, supernatural God sitting in a galaxy somewhere doesn't make any sense to me, so I'm not going to believe that. I'm going to call it a force or an energy. And I go, well, you already called it force or energy, why call it a God? Because the moment you use the word God, it imparts a certain attributes, and that's where the problem comes. So I think animism is a very, very primitive religion and runs parallel to the knowledge or civilization of that particular group that's practicing. Yes.
Yeah, I don't know the Bible well, but what little I know is that there are a number of places in that whole, the whole story where people hear voices, they hear commands, they see visions, burning bushes, they see apparitions. Can you comment on that, that commonality where people are hearing and seeing things that aren't there physically? It just seems to be a recurring phenomenon throughout the story.
Well, there are, I think there are three aspects to that particular one. The one I mentioned about St. Teresa, that I think is seizures. People can have what's called temporal lobe seizures, and it brings on pictures that are in our memory. So Teresa, St. Teresa became a Christian and went to convent since the age of 12 years. So obviously she's thinking a lot about Jesus Christ. So when she has seizures, it's not unrealistic to have ideas or visions of Jesus. You know, that's a seizure, that's a pathology. But we have a lot of pictures of what we consider as gods that were taught to us as we are brought up as children, you know. So some of the neurons have the ideas of those. And there are periodically situations where these neurons are fired and you feel like you're seeing something. But the very last thing that I think, by the way, this is very exciting times because neuroscience is, more and more research is being done in neuroscience. And the so-called religiosity and mysticism are all going to be explained by neurobiochemical and neurophysiological processes. It's already happening. And I thought about this 2 years ago when I was making the movie, and I said, you know what? I think this is what's going to happen. And I know this movie, I hope, is kind of ahead of the curve about bringing this idea. And I was just telling Roy that Discover has a magazine. And it has a special edition this month called Your Brain. And one of the cover articles on that is God Only in Your Head. And it tells exactly all the phenomena that I talked about. So a lot of humans, if they don't have enough knowledge and understanding of their brain, an experience they may have that they cannot understand yet, they try to import mysticism or religiosity or supernatural feeling to it. But it's not. It can be very clearly explained by the existing knowledge related to neuroscience. And it will be in human, I mean, it will be in the discourse of the society more and more. It's going to happen. That's the only way this knowledge is going to go. So most of those will be very easily explained. Oh, by the way, let me just show one point. The so-called let me give an example of seeing this intense light when, you know, near-death experience and things like that. That's a phenomenon that's so universal because when neurons don't have oxygen or they're hypoxic, that's what everybody experiences. All right? And also this idea that they have sometimes this so-called out-of-body experiences where they feel like they're floating and looking at themselves from above and all those things. Again, they're all being explained by this. And they we have on the left side what's called temporoparietal junction, or TPJ. And you might have heard about these experiments. Some of the neurosurgeons in Scandinavian countries, they were doing surgery, and when they stimulated this in awake surgery, sometimes we do awake brain surgery to make sure that the tumor is being removed without causing damage to the nearby functional areas. And when they stimulated this, this lady consistently said, I feel like I'm floating above. So all these so-called mysticism and supernatural experiences are happening in our brain and will be explained. Yes? Hi, Sue, how are you?
So what do you think, will we ever evolve out of religion altogether? Or will there always, like...
Of course we will evolve. No, we will evolve. I tell you why. First of all, if you look at all the current demographics of believers and non-believers, the single demographic that's increasing is non-believers. It used to be around 3%. Now it's anywhere between 10 to 15%. That's a phenomenal increase. But of course, there are some, you know, details we have to sort out. But the point is that non-believers will be increasing in number. Now the second question, well, will we ever get out of the need for religion? You know, that's an important topic. I always think about it. When you talk about the question of God, I think there are two questions. One is a purely academic and cerebral exercise to find out an answer to the idea if God exists or not, without putting our emotions behind the answer, just being really objective. It's like, hey, is there life on Mars question, you know? It exists or doesn't exist kind of thing. But there's another question, which is, do we need God and why do we need God? And a lot of times the discussion, unfortunately, goes back and forth, and that's a problem. You must differentiate those. So if you want an academic, purely objective answer to this question, does God exist or not, the answer is no, other than an idea that a human creates depending upon their needs. But do we need God is a different issue. It's an emotional need, and it depends on a few things. One is, are you able to accept the finality of death, which is the human predicament? There's no other animal that is exquisitely aware of the finality of death a few years from now. So we are burdened by this awareness of our future, you know. Can we accept the finality of death? If you're capable of doing that, you don't need God, you don't need heaven. And as far as this idea of the purpose of life, the meaning of life, it's what you make it up to be. And you could have a very fulfilling, loving, productive and creative life till you die. But are humans capable of doing that? So if you're capable of doing that, you don't need God. And very lastly, unfortunately, because the knowledge as far as the idea of God or the natural phenomena that happen around us, to explain them, it took centuries. But what's happening is that there are, as I said, close to 6 billion people on the face of the earth, and I want to say maybe 3 to 7% are considered to be non-believers. So billions of people are raised with the religion. So for them, when they get to a point where they say, listen, it doesn't make any sense, they have to first undo the damage that has already been done for decades. So you have to be inquisitive. You have to seek knowledge that has not been given to you. And you have to undo the damage that has been done over so many decades, and have the ability to accept what may sound like the answer that you don't want to hear. And if you can meet all those criteria, of course we will get out of this idea of God.
All right, I have a, just so you know, there's a mic, so I'm going to pass the mic to the questioners.
Thank you, Dustin. I had a question more regarding the brain. So, and like reading a lot of articles and trying to educate myself on that. few weeks ago, we went to see the exhibition of Lucy in New York.
Huh?
And we were looking, because, you know, we had so many questions about, you know, where we came from and at what point we became human and all of that. So, you know, it really opened my eyes. But looking at the cranium, looking at the formation of all our predecessors, basically, it seems like, you know, there was no room for that frontal lobe, for the frontal cortex. My question is, I don't know how much do you know about, you know, all of this and, you know, I guess anthropology related. The question is, at what point did we develop or evolved enough in the brain to have the frontal cortex? I mean, you can see some of them starts to increase the forehead and the cranium, so you can see, I guess, there is something coming in there. But at what point have you, has there, you know, you would think that something before a human had actually a frontal cortex, enough to imagine and to use reasoning and all of that?
Well, did you read the article about artists just a few
yes.
weeks ago? Well, artists is said to be around 4.1 million years of age ago. And it is said to be possibly the common ancestor of other primates and us. Now, it still did have big head, like we humans do. But we have only pieces of information here and there about what makes us humans. You know, we have Homo habilis and Homo erectus, but Homo sapiens, which we are, and have the capability to think and act and create. If you look at the existing archaeological information, they think around 60, 70,000 years ago something happened that resulted in increase in the surface cortex of the cortex of the brain, which is the surface.
At that time, the brain still had this.
Yeah, yeah, but both of them must have happened simultaneously. In other words, the small cranium or a flat front part of the skull, which is the frontal bones, are different from ours, where we have the frontal bossing, where it's a little bit more open, and the neocortex, which is no other animal has it. But the neocortex, they think, around 60,000 years ago. But we don't have exact specimens to say that's exactly what happened.
Yeah, no, around the age, but I was because I've been basically wondering is at what point did we become enough human-like to start analyzing things that we're, that most animals don't.
Yeah. Well, the unfortunate thing about this is that you got to go by the knowledge that you uncover, and then you kind of guess. So based on the very early cave paintings and drawings, the cave paintings I showed in Lascaux were around 35, 40,000 years ago. But there were some similar paintings in Africa that date around 60, 70,000 years ago. But by the way, you know that. Every human came from a single source in Africa. So. What I'm saying is that up to 60,000 years, we think that there is possibly this change was already there. But how long prior to that it happened, I couldn't tell. I don't think. We need more information. And got to find fossils that have the kind of shape of the skull that we have. Yes.
Yes, hi. Which would you think is that has been the main problem for all this violence in the last 2,000, 3,000 years? That people don't respect other people's religion, the intolerance about other people's religion, or religion itself. My question for you is because it seems that, let's say, this beautiful country where we live is actually the country in which has a more diversity of religions, and it seems that we live all in peace. There's some other countries that actually are a lot fewer religions, and they seem that they don't respect other people, and there's a lot more violence. So my question for you is,
yeah, religion. To me, religion is a tool used by humans to advance their selfish interests. It's the selfishness that's responsible for all the conflict. But religion is a very powerful emotional tool to recruit people. For example, the Crusades. Pope Urban was the man who went to France and gave this talk because there were local fighting of the kings in Europe, and they said, well, why are you fighting among yourselves? You must unite and go fight the Turks and reclaim Jerusalem. And if you die, you're dying for a noble cause and you'll go to heaven. But the kings were smart people. They said, wait a minute, I have to go across all the way Europe, cross Mediterranean, go to Jerusalem. What are the odds of me winning the war and coming back in one piece? I'm going to think about it a little bit. It's the peasants who were poor, who had nothing to lose, who were hungry, starving. They said, I got nothing to lose. If I win, great. I have the glory. If I lose and die, I go to heaven. So First Crusade apparently was predominantly peasants. And if you look at every one of them, it was a selfish interest. So if you break down any religion right now, I mean any war on the face of the earth right now that has a religious influence behind it, it's still because of a few selfish people trying to advance their motives. I'll give you the one example is the longest war I mentioned in there, which is the Israeli-Palestinian war. It's about land. It's purely about land. But the Palestinians get tremendous support from Muslims. And the Jews get, the Israel gets tremendous support from Jews and Christians. It's all selfishness. But religion is a very powerful motivating and recruiting tool. Although there are some truly religious fanatics and fundamentalists who cause some violence just based on that.
All right. One thing I want to mention is, I noticed we're aware of that the facility is not doing what we're hoping with the temperature. And so I think what we'll do is we'll do one or two more formal questions, and then maybe we'll sort of adjourn formally, but maybe, but Vivek, will you stay around a little bit longer, and maybe we'll just move into the lobby there where it's warmer.
I stumbled in here really not knowing what I was coming to, and I'm entranced. I presume you represent an organization, but I don't know anything about it. And do you have literature to pass out to us?
Well, surprise, I'm a one-man organization right now.
The more
movie,
power to you.
Yeah, thank you. No, the movie, as you can see, is I just did it. I am in principle and philosophy a humanist. That's why Roy Speckhardt was the executive director of Humanism is. I believe in humanist principles. Obviously, I'm an atheist, and but I think we're all one. I didn't have this, but I have an 8-minute video called One. And I say this, you know, I have operated on people of different religions and different ethnicities and different nationalities. And when I open the skull and work on the brain, I can't tell the difference. They're all the same. And after surgery, we give only one kind of morphine, no matter whether English, American, Indian, Christian, Muslim, Jewish, it doesn't matter. By the way, there's no homosexual or heterosexual morphine either. It's all one. We're all one. And we do now have DNA evidence that says that every human came from a single source in Africa. We are all connected. But it is the religious and national and ethnic and cultural differences that we created that unfortunately rule the world and divide rather than unite us. You know? And when you look at the globe Earth, this beautiful Earth from space, there are no borders in any of these countries. We create it. So I don't belong to any organization. I just felt it. And I just wanted to say before I started the movie that the inspiration for me to make this movie was I started writing a book. And two-thirds of the way, I said, you know what, this will be a good documentary. Plus, I had an excuse to go around the world. So I said, I'm going to do this. But the honest inspiration for this was, every time I go to work and come back to work, I listen to National Public Radio or watch CNN. There's no single day that I don't see images of war. And I have two boys, and when I come home and the boys run into my arms, and I realize that out there, thousands of families and kids do not have the same basic luxury because they're war torn. And I said, I got to do something that's in my power. And that's the essence. That's why I could have talked about just creation of the idea of creator of God through brain, but I had to include what this idea of religion and God does by perpetuating some of these differences and wars. So that was the reason. I don't belong to any organization, but I'm affiliated in principle and philosophy with humanism.
Also, if you didn't get these on the way in, they'll be on the way out on the table. I'll give you a set, but make it easy for you. But the unless maybe we have one more, and then we'll do we'll adjourn to the lobby after this.
Great movie, by the way. But my question is not so cerebral, pun intended. How do I tell friends and family around the country, you know, how do I say, hey, this video is great, this movie is great. Is it for sale? Is it somewhere where I can send them a link to so they can look at it for themselves? They don't have the luxury, like me, of being able to see it in person with you here.
Yeah. Well, you know, I just did the film and put it out there, but I'm doing what's called Film Festival Circuit, you know, which we might have talked about yesterday. And it was shown in 6 film festivals so far, and it won actually 2 awards. But I'm going to wait till March, and I have a few showings. You know, in December, the Michigan Atheist Association is showing the movie. And one of the Center for Inquiries from Chicago wanted me to show it in June. But I'm going to wait till March, and then I'm going to put it out in the market. Then the links will be available. And in fact, next week, Creator of God, www.creatorofgod.com will be up and running. And there'll be an option for joining the email list, and I will absolutely send information when it's available. But I'm shooting for March. You know, I enjoyed the film festival run. It's a great feeling to be part of the film festivals. See a lot of people with similar creative ideas and enthusiasm and passion. But it's very time consuming for me. So. I talked to Roy, and I was very, very interested because I believe in humanism. I said, I'll be glad to do this. But hopefully March will be available.
I'm looking forward to it. Thank you.
Just one
more
question.
I might have come in a little late, but I'm going to miss that. Did you get assistance to create this
document? No, I didn't. The last one you saw, that the script written, directed, narrated, produced by me. But Yoda was my second son. Darth Vader was my first son, who was also the cinematographer for some other shots. I would put everything together and tell him, hey, just press the button on this cue and then turn it off on this cue. And in some other countries, some taxi drivers, I told him, hey, I give you some extra bucks. Just I just had the pad. I just loved it. I just loved the idea.
So it was just you and the camera?
Yeah, it's just me. I bought what's called a P2 Panasonic broadcast camera, which is high definition camera. And you can see it when you put it on the tripod, and it looks big, and people think, oh, he's doing a movie or documentary. And some places it's not a problem, but some places they want you to get permission from tourism industry. So what I do is that I get up first thing in the morning before the cops are up and have their donuts. I was able to get all the shots. Plus, it's the what's called the golden light. When the light is around 30 degrees or less, it's beautiful. So morning and evening is the best time to shoot. So most of the shots were done morning or evening. And sometimes the cops come and ask me, and I go, okay, I'll get the permission. But by the time I got all the shots, I mean.
Yeah. Well, thanks.
I really appreciate you guys coming. It's
yes.
A gorgeous
thank you all for coming.
Thank you.